welcome to this special edition of India Revival Mission. And joining me tonight is Mr. Piyush Gupta, joining me live from Singapore. He is the CEO of the DBS Group of banks in Singapore. And good evening, Mr. Piyush Gupta. Thank you very much for joining me. How are you looking at the world today, where Corona is the only buzzword and the most searched word, and virtually the whole world is grappling with the virus first, and then each and every country looking at their own precarious economic situation to find out a way of how to carry on life with the infection of COVID-19 and post-COVID-19 era?
Well, Navika, I think you said it well. The pandemic is obviously the center of everybody's mind and attention. At its heart, it's obviously a very human tragedy. And so the health implications, the life implications are quite dramatic, with over 4 million cases at this point in time. So quite clearly, looking after people's lives and healthcare is a big issue. But as you correctly pointed out, I think the challenge to the macroeconomies and the financial system is also, in parallel, a big, big issue. People have often called it the challenge of lives and livelihoods. I've had some people talk to me about health and wealth. And in truth, both are important. And the fact is that the macroeconomies are looking very, very fragile. In fact, it's quite likely that this will be the worst depression we have seen since the 1930s. The IMF had projected a minus 3% number barely 4-6 weeks ago. And where we sit today, that number looks optimistic. The GDP numbers for the US, for Europe, for country after country are coming well south of that. Unemployment is through the roof. The adjusted unemployment in the US today is north of 20%, close to 25%. The last time we saw that was in the 1930s. In India, we have over 100 million people were unemployed, all of the daily wage workers and labor. So it's quite clear that the scale of damage is going to be quite dramatic. There is huge, a genuine destruction of demand. And when you have this scale of destruction of demand, it is very hard for the economy to bounce back in a hurry. So I have to say that if things are not looking that good. And frankly, as we go later into the year, if you have a phase two of the pandemic, which looks to be the case, I don't think you're going to see a vaccine in anything less than 2 or 3 years, then you're going to continue to see a stop and start situation in the economy. It's not going to be any of the alphabet soup of recoveries, U or L or V. It's going to be a stop start state year after year for a couple of years. But that doesn't bode too well either.
Well, I'm overwhelmed with the doomsday scenario that most of us have been thinking about. But when it is spoken out, it comes as more of a shock. But I want to ask you, some people have predicted that developing countries like China and India will see a 1.9 or a 1.2% growth rate in the current year, but it could bounce back to something like 7.5 for China and 9% for India next year. Do you see that happening? Do you think that's a realistic assumption that people are making, or are these projections based more on trying to lift up our spirits than reality?
Well, Navika, let me first deal with the projections for this year. My own sense is that those projections could also be a tad bit optimistic. If you look at India's data through March, and obviously we didn't have some data released in April, but at DBS we track early leading indicators. The data is looking pretty dismal. The actual industrial production data for March was down 16%. But perhaps the PMI data for April is more revealing. The manufacturing sector data was down to 27, and the services sector was down to 5. Now, both these aggregates are the lowest in Asia. And they're the lowest in Asia because the scale of our lockdown in India has been more comprehensive than any other country. But the extent of the slowdown in the economy, therefore, this year, could be worse than we're projecting right now. I would not be surprised if you wind up struggling to even get a positive GDP number. Now, your question of, therefore, do we get a bounce next year? First of all, if you have a low base year this year, then that obviously portends well for a relative year-on-year comparison next year. But I do think the bounce is predicated on two or three things. Number one, as I mentioned before, it is a function of the pandemic itself. If the pandemic continues, if you don't see a recovery, if you see a lot of stop-start, I think you will continue to see a challenge. Part of the answer to that, of course, is how good is your testing facilities and how good is the healthcare system. But I think part of the answer is not in our hands. It is, can we find a cure and can we find a vaccine? So that's one uncertainty. The second challenge is really a challenge of the financial system. I believe that while the real economy is suffering this year, you will see the challenges of the financial system really come to fore next year. And that's because in many ways, all of the central banks, including the RBI, are just kicking the can down the road. They're buying time. And I'm not saying that in a negative way. I think it's the right thing for them to do. You have to take care of the emergency situation that you have on hand. But the point is that you cannot buy time indefinitely. So what will happen is that many of the companies that are not able to recover will start filing for bankruptcies, and that will happen at the end of this year or early next year. Now, India, the financial sector was already fragile. The state of bad debts in the system is high. And if you overlay that with a whole incremental set of non-performing assets, I think availability of finance and credit could be a big constraint to the bounce back next year. So that's the second thing that we need to worry about. I think the third thing we need to really worry about is, in this crisis, maybe we can talk about it a little bit more later, but we have to play defense and then we have to play offense. And I think some of the measures, including the measures announced by the finance minister just today, are very good defense measures. You've got to save lives, put money in the pockets of people, make sure people don't die of starvation, try and make sure that you keep companies going. But next year's growth will not come from the defense measures. Next year's growth can only come from the proactive offense measures, and we have yet to see some of the pronouncements we hope to see in the next two or three days on land, labor, reform, etc., that will help drive some of that incremental growth.
So you're saying that we're even today with the 20 lakh crore package that has been announced, we're still playing defense. Do you think the longish lockdown of about 50 days has been a defense mechanism? Also, Mr. Piyush Gupta, you would know that the population that we're dealing with, 1.3 billion people, if it were to go out of hand, forget defense or offense, we wouldn't be there to play at all. The fact of the matter is, probably the lockdown was necessary when it was imposed. I want to ask you two questions. Was a 50-day lockdown too long? And now, should we continue to be defensive about a graded lifting of the lockdown, or should we just go with our eyes closed and just go for it?
So, Navika, I'm in the camp which says the lockdown was sensible and necessary. This is a hotly debated subject across the world, the lives versus livelihoods debate. But in my view, in the face of uncertainty, lives are important. As the ex-Prime Minister of New Zealand said, Helen Clark, economies can recover, the debt cannot. And therefore, trying to make sure that we protect lives is the imperative of every government. So I think it's a sensible thing to do. Going forward, is 50 days too long? It's very hard to make that case. Even today, the number of cases in most countries is increasing. You look at Singapore, where I sit. The government was a lot more calibrated in the first instance. We did not have a general lockdown. We did very strong testing, tracing, quarantining. We were selective in shutting down the economy. Guess what happened? We had a second phase where the virus went out of control. And so subsequently, we had to have a lockdown. I think, therefore, it is very easy to suggest that maybe a lockdown we could have done without. I don't think it's that easy to actually pursue when you weigh human life. Now, the next step, how do you get out of the lockdown? I think the current approach is also somewhat sensible. I think the right way to do it is to do it in a graded way. This is what Singapore is going to do as well. We will have the first step of the lockdown end of this month, and we're going to open only some sectors of the economy and go step by step, testing and learning as we speak. So earmarking the red, orange zones, etc. in India is not a bad thing to do to my mind. So I recognize that this creates a lot of hardship, but we have to make the trade-offs. So I think these are probably not unreasonable trade-offs to make.
So you said that the package announced today by the finance minister is still playing defensive. What would you have rather seen, which would be a measure of the offensive game that we are now getting into? What would you have seen in these announcements?
Well, Navika, you have to remember that the finance minister is supposed to be making announcements over the next several days. The total set of package that's announced by the prime minister is much larger than what the finance minister covered today. When I say that these are defensive, I think it's not derogatory. I think it's an important thing. But they're focused on two or three crucial aspects. Number one, they continue to focus on putting money in the pockets of individuals. It's a good thing. Second, I think one really good part of today's packages was the support for the MSME sector, both debt financing as well as sub-debt and equity financing. I think that's important, and frankly, I think that's a really good part of the package that many countries are missing. I think debt is not going to be enough. Many of these companies are not just going to suffer from a liquidity problem, they will suffer from a solvency problem. And the only way you get out of the solvency problem is by recapitalizing the companies, and therefore the equity support, I think, is really helpful. I think it's a smart move. I think the other part of the package today, which I think is very good, is to give support to the NBFC sector. I couldn't make out clearly, but I think the suggestion is through the RBI actually purchasing bonds from the NBFC sector. If that happens, I think that's also a good move. Now, when I put all of these, I still call them defensive. It is buying time. It is saving jobs. It is putting money in the hands of people. When I talk about an offensive posture, it is the rest of the things the Prime Minister has alluded to, that we need to do labor, land, liquidity, etc., reform. And I think this is a fantastic time for India to leverage some of the global disconnects in the global economic system. Now, what do I mean by that? Number one, geopolitics, everybody knows. And as the U.S. election gets closer, I think the geopolitics between the U.S. and China are going to be even more important. That's linked quite tightly to shifting of global supply chains. Without a doubt, people are going to nearshore, maybe onshore, but certainly people are going to be looking for resiliency. So supply chain shift out of China into Southeast Asia and South Asia will accelerate even more than we've seen. Third, it's quite clear that the digital takeoff is going to happen. What that means is that we will see what the Microsoft today calls remote everything, remote everywhere. That actually can play to India's strength, because our capacity to be able to work from far and use technology is unparalleled. So we could leverage that in really important ways. What could we do? We could drive telemedicine, we could drive tele-advising, we could use Indian talent sitting in India and be able to provide capacity around the world. I think the opportunities for therefore building out the right industries that we need to work on, industries for the future, those opportunities exist. To shift some of the supply chains to India from China and Southeast Asia, those opportunities exist. Working on the appropriate policies to be able to support those macroeconomic trends and shifts, that's what I would call a forward-looking and the offensive part of what we need to do.
So Mr. Piyush Gupta, I want to ask you this. You also realize that India is a democracy. It's the largest democracy. And in India, labor reforms, when they are announced from the center, mean something else in terms of posturing, but they have to be implemented on the ground in states. It's a federal structure. Do you think it's going to be as easy as the announcement made by the Prime Minister? Because some political parties do see that if they do not take the opportunity with both hands at this point, they will be virtually relegated to the annals of history. But the fact of the matter is that there is a lot of opposition and states controlled by opposition, and therefore, is it really going to be as easy as what it appears on the drawing board to start labor reforms, to start land reforms, in a country like India?
Well, it's never easy in a country like India, and those are the challenges of being a large democracy. But Navika, my experience has been that if ever you need to take bold action, you have to do that when you have a burning deck. And without doubt, this pandemic is a burning debt. They say often, never waste a good crisis. Now, this is a crisis that we can leverage to do things that are hard to do in normal times. You have to do it in balance. So that's why the earlier comments I made about defensive, you have to make sure that all of the various prime minister schemes, putting money in the pockets of the poor, making sure jobs are protected to some extent, you keep doing that to buy some cushion. But at the same time, if ever we have the opportunity to make far-reaching changes which can have impact, this is the time. Several of the states are actually BJP states, and perhaps it might be possible to drive further acceleration in some of these reforms in those states better than the opposition states. I don't know. I also believe that in recent years, the federal nature of India's polity has actually been helpful. Some states, even opposition states, have been actually quite proactive and productive. So if you create competition between the states, that actually does seem to help. I'm not being naive. I don't think it will be hunky-dory and easy all the way through. All I'm saying is that we have an opportunity for India at this point in time that is actually quite unique, and we do have that burning debt that allows us to catalyze actions that are difficult to do in normal times.
From where you're sitting, Mr. Piyush Gupta, how do bankers, how do people in the financial world look at the Prime Minister Narendra Modi, the leader that he is? At this moment, do you think the financial world in the southeast of Asia will look at Narendra Modi, the Prime Minister of India, as somebody who can deliver on all of these to take advantage of the possible shift of bases from China to India?
I think the best thing India has going for it right now is that there is a lot of international credibility and faith in the Prime Minister's leadership. Perhaps more outside the country than even in the country. People see the administration as being decisive and being willing to take action. Now, having said that, people also realize that India is a difficult territory to negotiate. As you correctly said, every state has its own agenda. Local politics is different from national politics. Bureaucracy often gets in the way. But I have to say that from a leadership and a decisiveness standpoint, the current administration actually scores high marks.
So do you think companies who are looking to shift base are going to factor that in? Is India going to be a favorable destination, or are they going to look at countries like Vietnam, countries like maybe Malaysia or other countries in South Asia where they could go? Can India actually get them in first?
Navika, we've got one important thing going for us. And that is that all the other countries are quite small. When you look at the scale of China's manufacturing capacity, it is massive. And there is no country barring Indonesia which has the wherewithal and the capacity to be able to absorb a shift in the supply chain of that magnitude. In Vietnam, even within 3 months of the shift, land prices and labor prices started escalating because the capacity of the industry of the country to grow tends to get capped off. The same is true for countries like Malaysia. Indonesia is a possibility. It has the labor, it has land, but Indonesia has its own set of challenges. What India has going for it is the language. It's got the technology. It's got a general acceptance of foreign investment. It's not as nationalistic as some of the other countries. What India's big challenge, of course, is the bureaucracy, the ease of doing business, and the policy framework not flowing down to the states and on the ground. And that's why the set of reforms that we can put in now and any measures that we can put in to really facilitate foreign direct investment and people shifting can actually be very helpful. Remember, many companies will actually not even try to shift in the region. Many companies will indeed try to onshore back to the U.S. or back to Europe. I believe in the medium term, however, resiliency will be matched against efficiency. And if we can create an efficient alternative in India with some degree of reliability, I think the country can actually bring in a lot of investment. But yes, we need to put in the wherewithal and focus on the ease of getting some of these things done better than we've been able to do in the past.
So, Mr. Piyush Gupta, before I let you go, I want to ask you, you know, the world is talking about protectionism, and so has the debate begun in India. When the Prime Minister yesterday spoke about Atmanirbhar Bharat, he also has sparked off a debate on Swadeshi. Do you think this Swadeshi, you know, which is also, in other words, going to be looked at as a protectionist policy, is that going to be somewhat of a deterrent for foreign investments? Do you think that? Or is he really meaning that Swadeshi actually means that if Apple has to produce phones, then it must produce in India so that it creates employment in India? How do you... you know, from Singapore, look at that statement.
Well, I think your latter statement is what I think should be the agenda. I think a policy of Atmanirbhar, which takes us back to the 1950s and 1960s, which is of an inward-looking India, of an India which is willing to compromise for mediocrity as opposed to compete with global best practices and global quality, would not be good for the country. And it would effectively put us back on the old Hindu rate of growth. But if you define it the way you did in your second statement, which is we welcome foreign investment, we welcome FDI, we just need to make sure that companies that come into the country have enough of an agenda in the country to create domestic value add, then that is not a bad thing to do. Frankly, I think India needs FDI today more than it ever had before. If you look at the totality of the fiscal programs announced by the government, the fiscal deficit for the year is going to be quite astronomical. Even without the program, just the revenue shortfall will take the fiscal deficit from 3.5% to 5 or 6%. And then if you layer on some of the new programs you're talking about, you're looking at an 8 or 9% deficit number. And then you add in the states and the rest of the government obligations, including the off-balance sheet obligations from the credit guarantee program. These are very sizable deficit numbers. We do not have the capacity in the country to be able to take those on. I haven't even talked about the banking sector. As I said, the banking sector has already been challenged before this crisis. I think after this crisis, the banking sector is going to be even more challenged. And without a shadow of doubt, we're going to have to recapitalize that financial system very, very considerably. Again, as a country, we do not necessarily have the resources to do that. Therefore, taking a more open and expansive attitude to foreign direct investment and flows of money coming into the country is actually not only a good thing, it might be the only practical way for us to grow out of our investment limitations. So bringing the money in is not a challenge. The challenge is really how do you utilize it in a way that creates the domestic value add that I referred to before.
Well, that is really the definition that India will have to make public sooner than later. But it's such a pleasure speaking with you, Piyush Gupta, because having an expert who's also an Indian sitting in Southeast Asia, sitting in Singapore, and looking at the Indian situation, clearly you have an understanding that is unparalleled about the Indian situation and gives us a glimpse of what we are looking at in post-COVID India. Thank you very much, Mr. Piyush Gupta, for joining me on this big India revival mission.